Out earlier, Chris, and Bill too. This is ceremonial that we wouldn't have seen had Her Majesty the Queen not passed away in Scotland. It's a feast of ceremonial that would have remained forever unperformed.
Might never have happened. No, that's right.
And with me is Major General Sir William Cubitt, who was commander of the Queen's Household Division until 2011. What are we looking at here, Bill?
The Guard of Honour of the Royal Regiment of Scotland has just given a royal salute to the King, and he has just reviewed the Guard of Honour by moving along it and talking to a few members of it, which will obviously be very special for them. And now he's returning back to the door of the palace with the General Officer of Scotland.
Of course, all these young soldiers serve the crown, don't they? And so they will have, until this moment, really this last few days, have served the Queen, and now they are serving a king.
That's right, that's always the case, the armed forces of the crown. I'm sure they'll all be extremely proud to be part of this. I think now we're seeing the ceremony of the keys, where the keys of Edinburgh are handed to the sovereign.
So this is the Lord Provost of the city of Edinburgh, who is handing the keys to the king for the first time. Let's remember that the last time this was done, it was for Her Majesty the Queen. And he's just handed them back.
That's just back in June, and Holyrood week,
that's
you
right.
said.
Yeah. The King's reply, by the way, is, "I return these keys, being perfectly convinced that they cannot be placed in better hands than those of the Lord Provost and councillors of my good city of Edinburgh."
And the King's now moving along the line of dignitaries. And a very exciting moment, I would hazard a guess, for all of them. A historic moment. Yeah.
These are city councillors from the city of Edinburgh who were being introduced by the Lord Provost, who will shortly take his leave at the entrance to the palace. The entrance, of course, that the Queen's coffin was carried into by that bearer party yesterday. And what a weight of responsibility on those young men yesterday.
And so the King will shortly walk into the palace to be reunited with the coffin of his late mother. Bill.
Yes, he has not been with his late mother since he left Balmoral Castle on the day after her death and flew to London. Of course, Princess Anne, the Princess Royal, the Queen's only daughter, accompanied the coffin on its journey from Balmoral yesterday. And she will incidentally fly with it when it makes its journey later this week to London.
And what will be happening inside the Palace of Holyrood right now?
Well, Mary, the Queen's coffin has been resting overnight in the throne room, and a vigil has been mounted by the Queen's chaplains in Scotland. I don't know what point we start calling them the King's chaplains in Scotland, but the guidance we were given was that overnight the coffin would be looked after by the Queen's chaplains in Scotland. And then we await a moment in the not-too-distant future now, when the royal family will line up outside, and then the coffin will be brought back out in front of the cameras once again for that journey to St Giles Cathedral.
And that journey will take place in the same hearse that we saw yesterday, again with the Royal Standard of Scotland draped over it, as it has been since it left Balmoral.
Yes, there will be a wreath of flowers on top. We'll have more details on that later, of course. And it'll be a very sombre and silent moment as it departs from here. It's actually not a very long distance between the Palace of Holyrood House and St Giles Cathedral. You just saw the King pass it in the car. But I think the journey on foot and at the speed they will be walking will take about 25 to 30 minutes when it happens at about 2:30 this afternoon.
And as we saw, the route is lined. That's a magnificent shot, isn't it?
And that is some of the congregation entering St Giles Cathedral, ready for the service of prayer and reflection later today.
And so you join us in Edinburgh today as we prepare for the body of the late Queen, Queen Elizabeth, to be moved from Holyrood House, the palace behind me here, to St Giles Cathedral in the next half hour or so, escorted by her son, the new King, King Charles III, who has, in the last half hour, arrived. He's flown up, arrived at Edinburgh Airport, and had a convoy through the outskirts of the city and arrived here about 20 minutes ago. He had a walkabout in the flower garden just beside the gates of Holyrood House and met some members of the public who'd gathered there to see him. And already very moving scenes, Chris.
Yes, this is the flower garden where many people had been already arriving to lay their tributes to the Queen, and we've seen the number of floral tributes grow and grow, be that at Buckingham Palace, where they're now being left in Green Park, or be that outside Balmoral Castle, and as well here in the capital city of Scotland.
And Major General Sir Bill Cubitt is with me as well, our expert on all the ceremony that we're going to be seeing today. And it is already magnificent. We've seen the ceremony of the keys, we've seen the Royal Regiment of Scotland.
That's right.
It's a real spectacle, isn't it?
It is. And what we're going to see is the bearer party from the Royal Regiment of Scotland, who will actually carry the coffin out of the palace. And then on the procession, they will be alongside the hearse, and outside them will be an escort party of the Royal Company of Archers, now the King's bodyguard for Scotland. And we've seen some of them in the background. You can see there, resplendent with the eagle feather coming out of their bonnets in their green frock coat.
And there, the ceremony of the keys, the Provost of Edinburgh offering the keys to the King. And then, as ceremony demands, the King gives them back and says, you're the best man for the job, to hold on to them. Ancient ceremony. And in just a moment, I think we'll be able to go back to see some of those crowds outside St Giles Cathedral and along the route. And there has been a magnificent turnout, hasn't there, already, Chris?
Yes, I think if you've got a spot on the Royal Mile at the moment, you're not going to give it up easily. If you were there to see the King arrive earlier with the Queen consort as the cars drove down the Royal Mile, I don't think you're going to go anywhere in the next, hour and a half before the procession makes its way up. And I'm just, you know, it's such a narrow street. It's full of history. And yet I just think it's going to be so silent, respectful silence, just as we saw yesterday in various places along that long 6-hour route. I think there's going to be a lot of a lot of crowds there, and I'm not sure there's any room there at the moment for anyone else to join them.
Well, one person who has got one of the lucky spots along the route is Sangeeta Lal, who has a front row seat. Sangeeta, what's happening there?
Well, thousands are filtering through here to try and get a position along the Royal Mile to see the Queen. And even though people here are united, mourning their shared loss of her, there was a real sense of hope when King Charles III passed through here. The crowd cheered, but in quite a calm and somber way. Of course, they're here to pay their respects to the Queen, but they're also here to offer their support to the royal family. And this crowd is about 15 people deep, so it's quite a way to get to the front. I managed to get through there earlier and spoke to a few people at the front. They told me they've been waiting here since about 5 o'clock this morning, and not just from the UK, but across the world. I actually met from people from as far as America and Canada and Spain, who are here specifically to pay their respects to the Queen. And actually, the crowd became very silent as council members and officials of the procession have made their way through here. But in between that, there have been singing, many people here singing God Save the King. And I'm actually joined by 11-year-old Aaron and your dad, Stuart. Hi, both. I know that you were joining in with the singing. Why did you think it was so important to be here?
It's just because it's a historical moment. It's like you want to celebrate it.
Yeah, and that does feel like what people feel here today, to celebrate the Queen's life. How do you feel seeing so many people turn up here?
Well, that's actually a good thing, actually, because they're mourning because, like, the Queen's death, but also here to, like, see the royal family.
Yeah, and to be together.
Yeah.
And, Stuart, why did you feel it was important to bring Aaron here?
I just felt for Aaron, it's a once-in-a-lifetime, once-in-a-generation opportunity to both see the royal family, the reigning monarch, and also to send off the the Queen, who's unfortunately passed away.
And of course we saw King Charles III travelling down here ahead of the event later. How did you feel when you saw the car?
Well, it's exciting, as shouldn't be the correct word for a day like this, but it's definitely still an exciting moment to see the monarch.
And I know that you remember the moment when you heard the news when the Queen passed away.
I was just sitting there, news was on, I was listening to my headphones, and the next minute I hear the Queen said, I'm like, oh, like, what am I supposed to think right now?
Yeah, but a moment we're probably never going to forget. But how do you feel about King Charles III?
I feel sort of like mixed emotions a bit, like, I'm so sorry from like his Queen's, not like his mum's death, and then it's like, it must be like, happy to be like the king now.
And hoping to get the country together and moving on from today.
Yeah.
But you're waiting here since about 7 o'clock this morning to see the procession, which will hopefully be in the next few hours. Thank you both for your time today. Well, of course, people are here to pay their respects to the Queen, who is expected to pass through here in the next hour or so. She'll be followed by her children, who will be here on foot. We're not expecting Harry and William to be here, but she will then lie in rest in St. Giles Cathedral.
Sangeeta Lal on the Royal Mile waiting for the royal convoy there. Thank you for the moment. With me still, Chris Shipp, Royal Editor, Major General Sir William Cubitt, Commander of the Queen's Household Division until 2011. So all of this is familiar to you, of course, although it is separate to what you used to organise because it's the Scottish operation.
Yes, I mean, this bit is not familiar to me in Scotland because I was primarily involved in London. But nevertheless, I obviously am aware of what's going on now. So we've got a major piece of state ceremonial going on in Scotland today, which we've seen quite a lot of so far.
And we have the Royal Regiment of Scotland, and we also have the Royal Archers. Now, tell me all about them, because I think they will be unfamiliar to most people.
Now known as the King's Bodyguard for Scotland, the Royal Company of Archers. Their origins go back to the 17th century, when they were formed effectively as an archery association. And in 1706, Queen Anne gave them a royal charter, which gave them the right to use any archery ground in the kingdom. And in return for that, every year they gave her three arrows in a ceremony called the Redendo ceremony. And in 1822, they were made the King's bodyguard on the state visit of George IV to Scotland, which was orchestrated by the novelist Sir Walter Scott, who was very keen on all the ceremonial and Scottish regalia and so on and so forth. So since 1822, they've been the sovereign's bodyguard. Hence, this year was their 200th anniversary. So a very special year for them being 200, but also a very prominent position today. You'll see them they're very obvious archers. They carry longbows and swords, and they're dressed in green frock coat, green trousers. On their cap badge, there's a white silk brocade, which is actually a relic of the Jacobean army's insignia, which is the only one left in the British military, not that they are actually in the army. So it's very interesting that. And so they're going to be escorting the coffin up the Royal Mile to St Giles's, and then there is a guard of honour of the Royal Company of Archers at St Giles's.
Of course, the Royal Regiment of Scotland was amalgamated from some very famous units like the Black Watch, wasn't it?
That's right. I mean, this company of Royal Regiment of Scotland that has just done the Guard of Honour is called the Balaclava Company, which is obviously the Battle of Balaclava in Crimea, rather topical at the moment. When the various Scottish regiments, including the Royal Scots, the 1st Regiment of Foot, the senior regiment of the line, conducted the Thin Red Line, which some may have heard about, to repulse Russian forces. And so there have been many Scottish regiments over time, but there is now just the one, the Royal Regiment of Scotland, with three regular battalions and two reserve battalions.
It is extraordinary, isn't it? There's this continuity. All of this previously would have seemed to many people, I'm ashamed to say myself included, as dusty old history, not relevant at all. But suddenly here we have it brought to life in fabulous technicolour and so relevant and so fresh.
The Accession Council on Saturday, yes. Dusty old history, as you eloquently put it, it was brought to life by live television pictures of the King meeting that room full of privy councillors, and of course the whole Privy Council thing dates back to a time well before Parliament, when they were private councillors to the monarch of the time on matters of state. So all of this, these little bits of our history, we had a royal historian on the programme the other day who described it thus. She said it was like looking under the bonnet of the British Constitution.
Yes, isn't it? Yeah, that's such a good way of putting it. And they're what may seem eccentricities when looked at from abroad or even within this country. There is a reason for all of them, isn't there?
Well, there is. And although there's only one Royal Regiment of Scotland at the moment, it does, in the uniforms and in the traditions, it does actually hold what they call the golden thread of all those antecedent regiments. And that is not just sort of for show now. It's very important to those who are serving, and even more important to those who have served in those antecedent regiments that now form the whole regiment.
And you were talking, Chris, you referred to the accession day and the trumpeters and the announcement that was made on at St James's Palace. Again, was extraordinary to behold, wasn't it? Because there were people with their mobile phones, but there was this ancient tradition harking back to the days when there weren't even newspapers, let alone television and internet.
Yes, I mean, that was how things were announced previously, that the monarch had died and a new monarch was being proclaimed. And standing on that balcony in front of Friary Court, a very, very ancient ceremony, but now brought to life by live television pictures. And of course, we're only remarking on the significance of that because we haven't had an accession council since 1952, when even ITV wasn't born then. So we're talking about events that predate modern television.
Yeah, when it was all black and white and all seemed so distant, didn't it? And yet here we are today in 2022, and all of these ancient traditions, these ancient ceremonies are happening right now and hugely, hugely relevant and significant.
And in full public view, whereas yes. Previously, years gone by, the public would not have seen them.
It's fascinating. And what are we seeing now? People arriving in St Giles Cathedral for the service, which is not a service of remembrance as such, Chris, is it?
No, the service of thanksgiving for the life of Her Majesty the Queen. Once the coffin is brought into this ancient cathedral, the service will take place. And remember, we had a service of thanksgiving at St Paul's Cathedral on Friday evening. The difference here will be that the Queen's coffin will be lying at rest in that cathedral after
Alex Salmond,
the service.
We can see there coming in.
The former First Minister of Scotland, Sir Alex Salmond, arriving. The King was actually met by the current First Minister of Scotland, Nicola Sturgeon, when he arrived at Edinburgh Airport a short while ago. But there was the former First Minister. Quite a beautiful shot looking.
It really is, isn't
from
it?
And
I spotted him in the Privy Council, actually, when all of that happened a couple of days ago. And the great and the good are all assembling for this very significant service of remembrance.
Quite an amazing moment. And actually, if people cannot get into the cathedral, then of course they get an opportunity over the next 24 hours to file past the coffin. Later on in the week, of course, there is a much bigger event over a period of 4.5 days when the Queen will be lying at state in the Great Hall in Westminster. And again, we're going to have even more ceremony and even more procession, even more poignant moments when the coffin is moved again with her family walking behind it from Buckingham Palace to Westminster Great Hall. But we've got this remarkable moment to pass this afternoon before all of that.
The service of thanksgiving coming up within the next half hour or so. For the moment, gentlemen, thank you very much. And it is expected that thousands thousands upon thousands of people will see the late Queen's coffin over the coming week. And today we found out the details of where and exactly when people can see it. Now, initially, that will be as it lies, at rest, not in state, but at rest at St Giles Cathedral here in Edinburgh. The public will be allowed to file past the coffin from 5:30 p.m. today, throughout the night, and until 3 p.m. tomorrow. After that, the coffin will be flown to London and thereafter taken to Buckingham Palace, where it will stay that evening. And then on Wednesday afternoon, it will be moved to Westminster Hall which we've already seen today, where the period of lying in state will begin. And the public will be able to walk past the late Queen's coffin from 5 p.m. on Wednesday until 6:30 a.m. on Monday. And that is the day of the Queen's funeral. That is Monday, the 19th of September. Well, the public have been warned that they may have to queue many hours to see the coffin. And our correspondent Ben Chapman is at Westminster for us right now. Ben.
Yes, people who want to come and pay their respects by filing past the Queen's coffin as it lies in state in Westminster Hall across the river from here will have to have exceptional patience and dedication. Such is the sheer scale of the queues that are expected to form over the next couple of days. On this side of the river, we're expecting the queues to run past here. There are some security staff already in place. Hundreds of thousands of people are expected to want to come here. The lying in state will take place from 5 o'clock on Wednesday afternoon, right the way through 24 hours a day, through until Monday morning at 6:30, the morning of the Queen's funeral. And yet, people have been warned to expect exceptionally long queues, to have to wait potentially overnight. They've been told to pack suitable clothing, to bring food and drink with them that they can consume while they're in the queue, to bring things like portable phone chargers, any medication they might need. And they've been warned that because the queue will be moving the entire time, they won't be able to sit down. And perhaps as a result of that, even though the official details of how the queue will work haven't been released yet, we have had the first person come down here this afternoon who intends to stay here over the next couple of nights to be the first in that queue. And I spoke to her a little earlier.
Yeah, to pay my last respects to Her Majesty the Queen. She did a good service to Britain internationally and also the Commonwealth. So she was very dutiful. He was calm. She was very steadfast. Lady is a great lady. Everyone respects. And it's very sad to learn that she passed on.
Well, people are also being advised about what not to bring if they choose to come down here and join that queue. Because it will be moving all the time, people have been told not to bring tents or camping equipment, flasks or hampers. There will be tight security when they reach the Palace of Westminster, so people are being told only to bring one small bag and not to bring anything which might normally cause a problem at, say, airport security, such as sharp items which will be confiscated. People are also being asked not to bring things like flowers, photographs, tributes to the Queen, and once they get inside, people are being asked to be respectful, to wear clothing that is respectful and doesn't include any political or offensive slogans, and above all, to be quiet once they're inside Westminster Hall. The Queen Mother, when she lay in state 20 years ago, attracted 200,000 people. The queue stretched across the river all the way down the embankment and for some distance along the south bank of this river. It is expected that those numbers will be dwarfed this week. Huge numbers of people expected to turn out and stand in that queue for many, many hours to pay their last respects to the Queen here at Westminster.
Ben Chapman at Westminster, thank you very much. And obviously, attention will shift to Westminster once the late Queen's body has been moved from Edinburgh, which will happen in a couple of days' time. But for the moment, attention is very firmly focused on events here. And the coffin is going to lie at rest, Chris, isn't it? Tell me what exactly is going to be happening.
So, about now, Mary, the bearer party is forming at the Palace of Holyrood House, awaiting that very onerous task, but I'm sure one that they will perform magnificently, to carry the coffin from the throne room down the great stair. And we will see the coffin for the first time since yesterday evening when it enters the forecourt of the Palace of Holyrood House. You can see there, that was the moment yesterday evening when it went in. Princess Anne had followed all the way down and just curtsied a few moments before this, as it passed into the colonnade through the front door, up the great stair, and into the throne room, which is where it has been at rest overnight. That journey is about to be made in reverse before it will return to the forecourt of the Palace of Holyrood House. And you think of the Princess Royal there. I mean, that was a very long journey she did yesterday in that car behind the hearse. A 6.5-hour journey, I think it was, in the end, passing all of those crowds. Edward, who in Scotland is known as the Earl of Wessex and Forfar, and it is those four children who will line up behind the coffin, along with Princess Anne's. Conclusion of that service, that the lying at rest will take place, and that's the moment when people here can start to pay their respects. And as Ben was just saying, I suspect a lot of it will happen well into...
Preparations are reaching the final few minutes for the ceremony of thanksgiving for the Queen's life that is going to be happening shortly. What is going on where you are, Louise?
Well, there are crowds all down the Royal Mile here. Thousands have turned out. Police are really stopping anyone more coming in because there is no more standing room. We've seen dignitaries filing into the service so far. We've seen former First Ministers of Scotland, Alex Salmond and Jack McConnell. Not yet seen the current First Minister, Nicola Sturgeon. She is due to do a reading in the service. But just about maybe 20 minutes or so ago, we did have King Charles III and the Queen consort coming down the Royal Mile, much to the joy of the spectators here who were cheering. It was quite unexpected. They just came round the corner here down from the castle, and that was obviously heading towards the Palace of Holyrood House. But that is the first glimpse of King Charles III, and say there were cheers. We obviously will expect that again, but that will be when the Queen's coffin is coming from at the bottom of the Royal Mile from Palace of Holyrood House up here into St Giles Cathedral. We're expecting the choir of St Giles to be singing as that happens. So at the moment there's really chatter amongst people. There's a little bit of excitement and anticipation, but as yesterday when the Queen's coffin passed, it becomes a very sombre mood, an almost hushed silence. So we're expecting that to happen again here today. The service, which will be celebrating the Queen's life and her connection to Scotland, will be led by Reverend Cameron MacLeod from the Church of Scotland. That will be taking place in St Giles Cathedral at around 3 p.m. Then from 5:30, that's when we expect the public to be able to file past the Queen's coffin, pay their respects and say their goodbye. But those people that will be doing that from 5:30 are actually in queues around the corner. They had to gather in the meadows before coming up here. So the crowds here, they will have the opportunity to see the Queen's coffin pass in the cortege, which will have King Charles III, the Queen consort, and other members of the royal family taking that final trip up the Royal Mile here and to St Giles Cathedral.
Beautiful, thank you. Louise Scott outside St Giles Cathedral, thank you. And Chris Shipp and Sir William Cubitt are still with me here. Chris, for anyone who's just joining us, run us through what we can expect to happen today.
OK, so it's all happening within the next hour. The key events within the next hour, when the Guard of Honour will start forming once again in front of the main entrance to the Palace of Holyrood House and await the members of the royal family who will file out just before the coffin. The Queen's coffin will be taken by hearse to the cathedral. The members of the family, we know it's the Queen's four children, which is now the King, Princess Royal, the Duke of York and the Earl of Wessex and Forfar, plus Princess Anne's husband, Admiral Sir Timothy Lawrence. They will file behind the coffin and walk up in procession to St Giles Cathedral, where there'll be a service of remembrance, which starts at 3 o'clock. Anyone here who wants to see the coffin can do so from 5:30 this afternoon. And that will be a period of 24 hours before the coffin will be taken to Edinburgh Airport and then flown to London. It's important to note, and the guidance from the Scottish Government is, that people are being made aware that this is likely to involve standing for a number of hours, potentially challenging weather. So come prepared is the advice from the Scottish Government. So if you want to pay your respects to the late Queen, there is an opportunity to do so in Scotland, a 24-hour period, and that begins at 5:30 this afternoon.
My goodness, challenging weather. Mind boggles, doesn't it? We've had wonderful sunshine, torrential rain, quite strong winds. Goodness knows what
else
might be coming.
Come.
Yes, challenging weather. Chris, thank you. That's all interesting stuff. So anyone who wants to come and see the coffin, it will be open for that from 5:30.
Yes, exactly.
But be prepared to queue for some hours. And there are thousands and thousands and thousands of people we can see along the Royal Mile there. And Bill, lots of ceremonial for those who enjoy that kind of thing. And we are very good at it, aren't we, in this country? We're famous for it.
We are. A unique selling point, perhaps, you might say. We're going to see the bearer party put the coffin onto the back of the hearse. And although it is going by hearse, it will be at walking pace. I think we should state that, because the rest of the procession is on foot. And whereas on occasions like this, you often have the route lined by the armed forces, that will not be the case here because it's so constricted, which just gives an idea of how close this will be to the public who are on either side of the Royal Mile.
It'll so be really intimate,
will be very, very intimate. They will then arrive at West Parliament Square by St Giles's, where there will be a Guard of Honour of the Royal Company of Archers. And that Guard of Honour is commanded by Lieutenant David Bowes-Lyon, a cousin of the Queen. So quite remarkable sort of feature of this parade.
Queen Mother's maiden name, of course.
Queen Mother's maiden name, that's right. And Lieutenant David Bowes-Lyon using the archer's rank, which go in the opposite direction from normal military ones. So it's another quirk, I'm sure, fiercely guarded by the Royal Company of Archers. So the Guard of Honour will then give a royal salute up at the cathedral, and then the coffin will go into the St Giles's. And I think the Guard of Honour will remain at the salute for 11 minutes, which is much longer than you normally do, but it's because of the nature of the ceremony.
A young girl I know said, it's just like Disney. She said, it's so exciting. And it there is an element of that, but everything has its significance and its reason, doesn't it?
And there is actually, Mary, one key poignant moment which will happen this evening, which is when the Queen's children will carry out their own vigil in the four corners of the coffin in St Giles Cathedral.
All right, lots more to talk about for the moment. Thank you very much. And you can see from the crowds here today just how much affection was felt for the late Queen in Scotland. And we know it was a place that she herself really treasured. At Balmoral, she felt she could truly relax and be herself. In return, the people of Scotland, and particularly her nearby communities, thought of Queen Elizabeth as a good neighbour rather than just their monarch. Scotland means a great deal to King Charles too. He, after all, went to school here. Our correspondent Peter Smith looks at the royal family's special relationship with Scotland.
We don't choose our perfect time or place of passing, but in Scotland, the Queen is said to have felt uniquely at ease, at peace among the people. And today in Edinburgh, thousands of those people have waited to show the respect is reciprocated.
I just think it's history in the making, and our Queen was such a gracious lady and deserves respect from all.
The Queen has always sort of been there as a sort of, seems a bit strange, but like as a sort of a granny figure, but she's just always been there.
We'll remember early appearances when she and Princess Margaret, as rather small girls, drove to Crathy Church during the royal family's stay in Balmoral.
The Queen's love for Scotland was born on childhood trips to Balmoral and endured her whole life.
Well, I suppose Balmoral is a place one looks forward to very much as the summer goes on.
As a young queen, she could have sailed the royal yacht Britannia anywhere in the world, but her holidays usually began in the Hebrides, exploring lesser-known Scottish beaches, having her children brave the chilly seas. Scots have had a rare view of this queen, relaxed in the outdoors, casually dressed, telling jokes at the family barbecue.
The Queen has always adored Scotland, always spent a long time at Balmoral, and always harked back to Queen Victoria's enthusiasm for Scotland. All the tartan, the castles and all the rest of it, you know, the fact that the royals wear kilts endlessly when they're in Scotland is part of them saying to the people of Scotland, look, we belong to you too. And that's really important because there is a different relationship between monarchy and people in Scotland.
Nowhere has this distinct relationship been more apparent than at the Braemar gathering. Year after year, we have seen genuine enjoyment and affection joining the community for their Highland Games. now at this place where the Queen smiled so often, a lone piper's lament. These are the local people who knew the Queen, holding their own private ceremony, away from palaces and the queuing public. They retire her chair and lay out the tartan blanket and programme from her last games.
She was just a very, very pleasant person who didn't come here to change things, but came here to enjoy things that were here.
And we have Highland Games now in America, Canada, New Zealand, Australia, and it's all thanks to the attendance of the royal family here at the Braemar Gathering that we are now recognised as the home of the World Games, Highland Games.
So they came here and they didn't just observe Scottish culture, they took part and then championed it internationally.
That's correct, yes.
The Queen also attended Crathy Kirk here and prayed alongside the local congregation. That's where she first heard Paul play his fiddle, then invited him to play for her in Balmoral. He played the same tune here on Saturday at a private service for the royals, an emotional moment just for her children and grandchildren. He sees the nation now mourn a monarch, but around here they are remembering their neighbour.
Well, a lot of folk probably wouldn't see, because you just see that side of the family, is that they held regular gillies balls. The Queen was up for about 50% of the dances, and the very first dance she was up and she was, come on, get up. And you could see the family there, just genuine belly laughing, having a proper good time. And I mean, that wouldn't be so much just the local aristocracy, but you would have found, like, the local butcher would be there.
The new king inherits a connection with Scotland that runs deep, but he knows this nation well. He is the first British monarch to have gone to school rather than be educated at home, and it was at Gordonston near Elgin that he attended for 6 years.
So this is actually what was King Charles's room. He was house captain. This is where he'd have slept and worked and socialised with his friends, and this is actually his desk.
While here, the young king played the part of Macbeth in the Scottish play. He also wrote about tough times here at boarding school, though later said the Gordonston education helped shape the man we see today.
Yes, we see so much of the Gordonston ethos being reflected in our monarch. We also see so much of Scotland reflected in our new monarch. We do think of the royal family as the Scottish royal family, and this connection with the sea and his career in the Navy and with the beautiful countryside around here and his commitment to conservation, his patronage of the arts.
That passion for conservation led to him stepping in to save Dumfries House in Ayrshire from being sold off, along with its prized Chippendale collection.
If you can provide a catalyst for that regeneration, using a house like this and its associated policies and everything else, then perhaps you could bring something back to life or give new hope and inspiration.
While people around here have embraced the royals as neighbours, it would be wrong to portray that as a universal affinity in Scotland. Cities like Glasgow and Dundee, far from these rolling hills, have become notably cooler on flag-waving and street parties. The Queen's former piper has seen the changes and understands the challenges facing the new king.
I think King Charles III has lots to offer. I think the royal family, whether people like it or not, are completely interwoven into the fabric of society. They're part of who we are.
As people of Scotland pay respect to the Queen before she leaves this land she so treasured one final time, we can see the legacy she leaves behind. A special relationship with Scotland, but also a complicated one. Now it is the King who inherits that great responsibility for maintaining this unique bond. Peter Smith, ITV News, Royal Deeside.
Well, some wonderful moments in that package there from Peter Smith, that report there. And I'm joined now by the broadcaster, Aisha Azarika, and Jim Murphy, who was Secretary of State for Scotland and leader of Scottish Labour under Tony Blair. So a few years ago now. Yes. Welcome both. It's a wonderful day, and we're seeing Scotland at its finest, aren't we, Jim?
Gorgeous. What a beautiful city Edinburgh is, and I say that as a Glaswegian. It's like
it must be difficult for you to say those words.
But the monarchy has been so important to Scotland, and Scotland's been so important to the monarchy. And as we saw those remarkable scenes from the helicopters yesterday, as the Queen's coffin travelled from rural Aberdeenshire, and here in this remarkable capital city, and the city's come out, it's a historic day. And I think the whole event initially being focused here in Scotland has just added something to the rich history of what's unfolding.
It's almost like the late Queen had planned it, because she loved Scotland so much.
She did.
It's her gift, isn't it, just to the Scottish Tourist
Board? She did, absolutely.
To show how magnificent
this,
it is.
This palace behind us, I wouldn't say regular, but often a guest at events here at Her Majesty presided over. And this has always been a sort of very happy place to come and visit today, of course. It's like we're reminiscing with a smile on our face, but it's also a sad occasion, and much more so, of course, for the family themselves, who are very regular visitors here in Scotland.
And they love it, don't they?
They do. I think Scots would see through them if they didn't, if it wasn't authentic. So Prince Charles has probably spent more time in Scotland, perhaps even more than the late Majesty the Queen. It's been the Duke of Rothesay, and some of his biggest, the issues that he's focused on, whether it's young Scots, whether it's Scotland's climate. I think there's about 100,000 young Scots who have been helped just through the Prince's Trust alone. And he invests a considerable amount of time and energy, personal energy, here in Scotland, whether it's in rural parts of Scotland, but also in Scotland's cities. And in particular, work that's rarely seen among some of the poorest people in Scotland who have been supported and helped and had their lives turned around through the Prince's Trust and the work that our now King has done across many decades.
It is said, isn't it, that there is less support for the royals in the cities themselves, perhaps compared to in the countryside. So what do you think? It's very difficult to sum up a mood, Aisha, but there does seem to be a particular warmth that we're seeing from the Scottish people today. And we live in changing political times, as we know, and now probably isn't the time or place to discuss the concept of independence. But there has been apparently a great warmth there.
Oh, absolutely. And I think you said it very well. It's almost like this is the Queen's final gift to Scotland. Scotland has been centre stage for these really important 3 days. Scotland has its place in the history books. The world's eyes are in Scotland. The weather gods have even smiled on Scotland, because Scotland is looking, every part of Scotland is looking majestic, and just, you can see almost the Queen showing the world why she treasured Scotland so much. And I'm sure people will be flocking here afterwards. But as you say, look, there are bigger constitutional and political currents in Scottish society right now. There are conversations being had. But certainly, from people I've been speaking to, whatever side of that constitutional question you are on, there is such affection for the Queen, and actually the new King as well. Just today, when I was coming in the taxi driver was saying, look, to be honest, I'm not that fussed about the royal family, if I'm absolutely honest, but the Queen, she was like a member of the family. And for so many people in Scotland, particularly around Balmoral and that part of Aberdeenshire, they didn't feel they lost a monarch. They felt they lost a member of their community. And she was very, very visible. She wasn't distant and remote. You tapped anyone on the shoulder in that part of the world, and they had a story about meeting the Queen. And I think Jim's right. She had an authentic love for the people of Scotland and coming to Balmoral. And that was reciprocated. Now, I don't know what that's going to mean for the bigger constitutional question. I'm sure everyone will want to interpret their own meaning from this. But what is clear is people feel very proud that Scotland has now got a very, very special place at this point in contemporary history.
I think all of that's important. And look, it's not for me to second guess, of course, what our new king will do. But a part of Scotland that's very special to him is in rural Ayrshire, a place called Dumfries House. Now, once the royal palaces and gardens reopen, I would encourage anyone who wants to come to Scotland to see our new king's work in Dumfries House. It's a place which he's restored.
Because it was a ruin, wasn't it?
It was a ruined building. It would have possibly been demolished, but he's invested in it. He's invested a huge amount of time in it. And it's now a place where young people in the community go to work. It's a brilliant garden. It's a place where uniformed services, boys' brigades, cubs, brownies, thousands of people go every year. And it's just a remarkable piece of rural regeneration, which, however, people from all over Scotland's cities now go. So while Balmoral, of course, is central since Queen Victoria's time in Scotland's story and the monarch's story here in Scotland, I think there'll be an additional component which runs right through the heart of Dumfries House in Ayrshire.
And just to pick up that point, and this is really important as we think about the new king and his relationship with Scotland, Dumfries House has been used really, really effectively across all parts of sort of civic life in Scotland. And just as the Queen felt like she was quite accessible to people, I think Prince Charles, when he was Prince of Wales, was very savvy about doing that. There are so many people across Scotland who have been invited to Dumfries House from the charity sector, from all, you know, he doesn't feel like a remote personality.
That's true.
He did really push that through, didn't he? Because it wasn't without controversy at the time, the amount it cost and how could it ever be paid for or something. But he made the right call, without doubt.
It was a personal mission of his. He believed in it. There were a huge number of cynics and sceptics, but he just was convinced that it was the right thing to do in that part of Ayrshire that isn't without its problems, like many parts of Scotland. But when you go there, it's formerly unemployed local young people who are preparing the food, who are working at it, who are tending the gardens. So it's, yes, there's a job creation, but it's just a sense of optimism about what can be done. And I think when I was there, one of the occasions I was there, to your point, Aisha, as I left, who was next in but the leaders of all of Scotland's trade unions? Now, I find that quite poignant, that the future king and now king just finds an opportunity to have relationships with the man or woman in the street, with the most senior business people in the country, but doesn't forget also civic Scotland, such as Scotland's trade union leaders. And I find that quite poignant when I was at that visit.
On a personal level, you've obviously met him a number of times. What kind of king do you think he will be? And what are your memories of the meetings that you've had with him?
I've enjoyed over the years meeting both the late Majesty the Queen. And the thing I remember most about that is, I think on one occasion, one of her attendants must have told Her Majesty that I was interested in horse racing. Now, I think she thought I was interested in breeding horses and owning horses.
Do you not have a string of racehorses?
My relationship ran straight through Ladbrokes, so rather than anything else. But she used to always give me tips, or she asked me for advice on horses, and would occasionally give me tips. And I would, the truth is, you're sitting in Buckingham Palace with the monarch giving you tips on which horses would win. And I was so overwhelmed by it, I could never remember the names of the horses to tell my dad to put a fiver on.
You could have made a fortune.
Absolutely. But with Prince Charles, I've got to know him in a small way over the years. And one of the things I'll be surprised about is whether he is able to maintain Her Majesty's sense of being on time for everything. Because he just loves meeting people. And so I've seen him in big crowds and small crowds, and he just takes a real interest in people's well-being. And that's very special.
Aisha and Jim, for the moment, thank you. Let's go straight over to Louise Scott, who is outside St Giles Cathedral. Louise.
Well, after the excitement from the crowd of seeing King Charles III pass down the Royal Mile, there's really been a bit of a hush recently, and that's because we now have the Guard of Honour outside St Giles Cathedral there. There was a military procession down from the castle to Parliament Square here with the military band and the Royal Company of Archers, which are now known as the King's Bodyguard of Scotland. And it will be them who will stand by the Queen's coffin when it lies to rest in St Giles Cathedral here. We're obviously expecting the procession with the Queen's coffin to come up the Royal Mile here, which will include King Charles III and the Queen Consort and other members of the royal family. And we've seen more people file into the service behind us here. And we actually just got a bit more detail and said that some of them, as well as politicians, council members, there's some from the Queen was patron of. So representatives from the Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland charity, the Royal National MOD, the Royal Scottish National Orchestra, the Scottish Football Association. Some really people from all walks of life at this service, which will be a celebration of the Queen's life and her connection to Scotland. And everyone here is just really waiting for that moment to see the Queen's coffin pass by and also a glimpse of King Charles III. And after it rained pretty much all yesterday evening and into the night, it's still dry here, which is really bringing out everyone who wants to witness this moment. We've seen young and old. I saw children earlier playing a game of Uno cards on the ground with their family. I've seen elderly people sitting on chairs, but all wanting to witness this moment. Not only are the world eyes on Edinburgh right now, but the world is here. We have tourists from countries all over the world. Some I was speaking to yesterday had actually extended their holiday to witness this moment. She means the Queen. She meant so much to so many all over the world. And of course, we know of her relationship with Scotland. And actually, St Giles Cathedral here, which is in the heart of the Royal Mile, it's where the Queen came in June 1953 after her coronation for a service of thanksgiving and a blessing from the Church of Scotland. So we can see just a few moments ago, Minister Reverend Cameron MacLeod, who will be leading the service, was standing outside, but he's obviously gone in. But that is the Royal Archers standing outside, standing guard, and I say they will be the ones guarding the coffin. And people, members of the public, will be able to file past the coffin once it lies to rest. From about 5:30, we expect to see people filing in, but they are being held at a different area. Queues already starting from this morning down the meadows, about a 15-minute walk from where we are now. So people here, if they do want to see the Queen's coffin from within St Giles, they will then, after witnessing this service, then have to make their way down and join the queue. And we're expecting the Queen to lie to rest here for around 24 hours time.
Louise Scott outside St Giles Cathedral, thank you for the moment. And the service of thanksgiving for Her Majesty the Queen will take place at about 2:30 this afternoon. But in the meantime, preparations are underway here at Holyrood House, the Queen's Royal official residence in Scotland, in Edinburgh, and where her body is lying at rest at the moment. And shortly, the journey will take place, a hearse, followed by a procession on foot, including the royal children, and they will deliver her to St Giles Cathedral for that service of thanksgiving. These are really, really big public state occasions, remarkable day in Edinburgh. Scenes now as the city awaits the procession of Queen Elizabeth's coffin along the Royal Mile, slowly brought to St Giles Cathedral. And as I said, following the coffin on foot, King Charles and the Queen's other children, Princess Anne, the Princess Royal, Prince Andrew, Prince Edward. And there will be a service for their mother, Her Late Majesty Queen Elizabeth, before the coffin lies at rest in St Giles for 24 hours. Royal Editor Chris Shipp is back with me, and Aisha Hazarika, broadcaster, political commentator, is still here. Quite a day even so far, Chris.
Yes, Mary, we can't obviously show you what's happening inside the Palace of Holyrood House, but you see some pictures outside there. What I can tell you is at the moment that the bearer party is been assembling inside the palace, and in the next few moments, at 20 past, the King and the Queen consort, together with other members of the royal family, will enter the throne room where the Queen's coffin has been resting overnight since she arrived here yesterday from Balmoral. The King and Queen consort will be accompanied by the Lord Chamberlain, the Dean of the Chapel Royal in Scotland, and the Minister of Canongate Kirk. And a prayer will be said at 20 past two this afternoon inside the Palace of Holyrood House. And about a minute after that, Mary, a bearer party will enter the throne room from the Great Stair, and they will begin the task of carrying the Queen's coffin.
And what are we looking at now, Chris?
This is St Giles Cathedral, where they are awaiting the arrival of the Queen just before 3 o'clock this afternoon, so in about half an hour's time. And the great and the good of Edinburgh are assembling in the cathedral, where they will wait for Her Majesty's coffin to drive up the Royal Mile with her immediate family following behind on foot.
And the Royal Trumpeter's here. about to deliver a fanfare, I am guessing.
Always a wonderful sound, wherever it's given. We've heard a lot of fanfares in the last few days for the new king, but a very somber moment, I think, for the king and queen consort, who are about to say a prayer in the throne room before the coffin begins its journey to St Giles Cathedral. Pictures from inside you're seeing right now.
The Queen's faith was hugely important to her, of course. We are being reminded in these last few days the religious aspect to what we're seeing from a constitutional point of view, leader of the faith in this country, King Charles, of course, now has taken over that role.
But yes.
The idea of faith and religion has really been at the forefront, hasn't it?
Yes, and of course there is a difference between England and Scotland, where the king is currently the supreme governor of the Church of England, whereas in Scotland, at the Accession Council, he had to swear an oath to uphold the Church of Scotland, all dating back to, as I'm sure Aisha knows, the Act of Union in 1707. But yes, and actually this service, as well as the service at St Paul's that we saw on Friday evening, all very much decided with the Queen in mind, her music. We spoke to the Queen's Master of Music, now the King's Master of Music, of course, and all of these arrangements. A lot of it was discussed with the Queen before she died.
Aisha, you're nodding very
much.
Yeah,
I mean, this is the location of and St Giles' Cathedral is an incredibly important part of Scottish history. As Chris said, a very important part in terms of the Act of Union. It is at St Giles' Cathedral where fiery sermons were read by John Knox. And of course, that was a very important part of the Reformation of Scotland. And as Chris said, when the accession oath was read out, Prince Charles has to swear to defend the Presbyterian Church. And of course, that goes right back to Mary, Queen of Scots, and Catholicism and Protestantism. So it's very, such historic roots there in St Giles Cathedral, a fulcrum really of politics and monarchy and religion coming together. And of course, we've seen a lot of the Scottish political leaders sitting there awaiting this moment. We've seen the leader of the Scottish Labour Party, Anna Sarwar, Douglas Ross, the leader of the Scottish Conservative and Unionist Party as well. So as Chris said, the great and the good there, and also a really important moment for the people of Scotland, because this is the first service that we will have seen where the Queen's coffin will be there. This is the first time that citizens will get the chance to come and pay their respects. So the fact that this is happening in Edinburgh, in this historic place, St Giles' Cathedral, it's hugely important.
And for anyone who isn't a student of history, and I'm afraid that I'm very much a part-timer at this, it's worth pointing out that the late Queen was not Queen Elizabeth II in Scotland, was she?
No, she wasn't. And of course, it goes back to you know, we forget about how much turmoil there was between Scotland and England, how much bloodshed there was before the Act of Union. That is not a comment on the bigger constitutional issues that are going on at the moment. But it was, the importance of all of that. And that's why, in terms of the language around what the Queen is, was or wasn't, and what the new king is and isn't in terms of Scotland, that's very, very important.
Someone with a very good view of proceedings there, just waiting with a quiet moment of contemplation for what's about to unfold on the Royal Mile.
A lot of people dressed in black today around Edinburgh, I've noticed. Not just those of us who are broadcasting, but people who are coming somberly dressed, often in full mourning.
I think it's a real occasion for the city. Certainly people I've spoken to who are not connected with politics or broadcasting like we are. The city is taking its responsibility, I think, very seriously today. It knows that the eyes of the world are upon the city. There was a huge amount of affection for the Queen. So yes, you are seeing lots of people in black. You are seeing lots of people wanting to take a moment to reflect on what the Queen meant to them. Mm.
Mary, we should point out that whilst we're looking at pictures of St Giles' Cathedral, the coffin right now is on a move. It has been lifted from the
inside
throne
Hollywood.
Room inside the Palace of Holyrood House. We will not, of course, see it until it reaches the front door of the palace. But the bearer party is currently bringing that coffin to the west colonnade via the great stair inside the palace. And we will shortly see the King and Queen consort assemble in front of the palace. We're still looking at pictures there of St Giles Cathedral.
Still people arriving, aren't
yes,
they?
Yes, but I think significantly, members of the Queen's household are now waiting in the forecourt of the Palace of Holyrood House, and we should never underestimate the impact that this had or has on them. This isn't just a family in mourning, it's not just a nation in mourning. The eyes of the world are on this country at the moment, but there are many, many people who worked for the Queen, worked for her for many, many years, who will be feeling this very deeply today, both at Balmoral and also those who worked with the Queen here in Edinburgh.
Nicola Sturgeon just arriving at St Giles Cathedral. You can see her.
That's her husband behind. And of course, Nicola Sturgeon,
as she
enters St Giles Cathedral, met the King. The first time she's had to do that when he arrived at Edinburgh Airport from London this morning, where he'd already taken part. Let's not forget the King's days was already very busy this morning after he went to address MPs and Lords in, and I think that Great Hall, Aisha, is a wonderful, wonderful part of the Palace of Westminster.
It's a wonderful part of the Westminster architecture. It's, you know, incredibly old and historic. It is, of course, where the Queen will lie in state. It's where the Queen Mother lay in state. And sometimes when you're walking through Westminster Hall in your everyday business in Parliament, you don't really get a sense of its majesty. It is a huge kind of space, but there's often lots of people milling around and you don't really get a chance to take in. But today, seeing the new King, seeing everybody set out and him making that very important first speech to parliamentarians was a real moment, and he spoke about Parliament being the sort of living, breathing instrument of democracy. And again, I thought from an oratory point of view, a very confident sort of first step from him in terms of his first sort of outing in Parliament.
Yes, very much so. And again, it just came home to me the sort of the melding of the personal and the constitutional and the historical. And there's a man in deep grief, of course, lost his mum. Anyone who's lost their mum will know exactly how he's feeling, and yet he has to move on now and do all the big steps of state that are required of him.
This is a family used to showing its private grief in the public sphere, of course. It's done it many times before. It did it in Windsor Castle for the funeral of the Duke of Edinburgh not that long ago, when circumstances were very difficult indeed during the height of the pandemic. But there's a hush. I think we should probably have a listen, if we can, to some of the hush that's probably descending on the Royal Mile at the moment as they await for this procession to get underway.
And here we are about to see the emergence of the coffin of the late Queen from Holyrood House, where she has lain at rest overnight as she starts the next stage in her final journey. This time she's at Giles Cathedral, the end of the very famous Royal Mile in Edinburgh. And this is the next stage in this meticulously planned and choreographed set of ceremonial. Chris?
Yes, here we are, the seat of the monarchy in Scotland, the smallest palace of all of those at the late Queen's disposal, now the King's disposal. And in front, in the forecourt there, in front of the fountain, the guard of honour awaiting members of the royal family who are due very shortly. And Mary, we will hear we will really see the Sovereign's Piper in a moment, with the Minister of Canongate Kirk, the Dean of the Chapel Royal in Scotland, and the Lord Chamberlain. And they will be followed by the King and Queen consort as they make their way out into the forecourt with other members of the royal family, Princess Royal, Duke of York, the Earl of Wessex and Forfar, as they emerge from the front door. and under the West Colonnade.
In military uniform, do we understand?
We do. We've been told today that there will be five events at which the royal family or members of the royal family will wear their military uniform. This is the first of them. The others will be later in the week when there's a procession from Buckingham Palace to Westminster, also when they hold vigil at the coffin.
We will not be seeing the new Prince of Wales today, Prince William, will we, as
no,
I understand it?
We did wonder if we would see the new Prince of Wales, who's called the Duke of Rothesay when he's in Scotland, and also the Duke of Sussex, if I remember rightly, the Duke of Hamilton when he's in Scotland. But they are not coming. It is just the Queen's four children and her son-in-law, Admiral Sir Timothy Lawrence, the husband of Princess Anne, who will file on foot behind the hearse when it makes its way shortly from the Palace of Holyrood House and up the Royal Mile.
And the Duke of York taking part in this, even though he is no longer an active member of the royal family.
He will, yes, and just as he took part in events for his late father's funeral, so too will he today. We're looking there, Aisha, at Arthur's Seat, and people with a very good view of proceedings, if a little far away.
It is magnificent, isn't it?
Arthur's Seat is an incredible vantage point, and we're very, very near it, and you can see so many people scurrying up there to get a view. And it really, you know, I know we sort of talk about the weather a lot, but it could not be. It's a beautiful, beautiful kind of Scottish day here. And we're all just so pleased it's not raining. And I think it's going to be an incredibly poignant moment when we do see the start of that procession. And the fact that it will be made on foot as well, I think, is incredibly symbolic. And also, it kind of signifies an accessibility, a visibility, and a humility as well. And I think for many of the people watching, that's going to be an incredibly special moment for them to witness.
And that's all due to happen at about 2:30, isn't it?
Yeah, anytime now, Mary, we should start to see the members of the royal family leave the front
Giles
door.
Giles Cathedral again, and Liz Truss arriving there. Brand new Prime Minister, as brand new as our new monarch.
Well, there's been a bit of interesting controversy around this because it was sort of indicated that the new Prime Minister would sort of accompany the new King as he tours around the regions. That's since been clarified by Downing Street, who have said she's not going to be accompanying the King. She will attend these ceremonies and these important services. And I think that's quite important for both sides, actually. I think she and the new King will have a very close relationship, but this is very much a point of monarchy and not politics today.
So it's a point of protocol. She is attending rather than accompanying.
Yeah, and they were and Downing Street did clarify that.
And it looks like with the rear of the hearse just been open, it looks like we're about to see